I'm not gonna lie, I spent like 10 minutes putting this together, so I'll be as surprised as everyone if I bring you slides. So, but, anyway, we've been using SwiftUI correction a lot, so I just want to quickly talk about that. So my name is Petr, and I was an engineer at a company called Curry Street Software. I copied this from our website. We're basically running gay social networks or dating apps, two of them. We have a lot of users, and so that's what's made migrating to SwiftUI pretty interesting. This is what those two apps look like. It's kind of two screenshots from App Store.
What's the difference between these two apps?
few colors are different, and I just realized that the right one says no crashes, just crashes or something. I don't know. Doing my best, and I also discovered that there is some like anonymous autoleaks called SwiftUI in New York, because I was Googling for our website, so not that one, the other one. Anyway, back to SwiftUI. So did I get the year? It's summer 2019. SwiftUI was introduced. I mean, the iOS community might have thought that Apple has introduced something revolutionary, but no, it just completely reacted. But it's, I'm glad they did, you know. So obviously, there was like back in iOS 12 days, and this was iOS 13. So I started thinking, like, so how can we start using this? And I got this idea that we can finally create a decent debug menu in the app, and you know, if it's OS 13 plus, that's fine for you know, developers and UA and stuff like that. So that's what we started doing, and I mean, debug menu is basically a bunch of tables we use. And what was interesting is how easy it was to basically keep adding stuff. Basically, the only annoying part is that when you have like SwiftUI view, you can only add like 8 sub-views. There's like some compile limitations, so once you like go after that, you're like, ah. So basically, if you took a look at our debug menu, it's not like segmented by what makes sense, but it's like split into those pieces of eight. You know? And I guess there's like some third-party frameworks that somehow like massage table use, something like that, but this has been like extremely easy to modify. Summer 2020, last summer, there was this, okay, we need new in-app camera in the app, so like, you just can, like, it's pretty boring, so like maybe you can try to write in SwiftUI. The reason for that is that every time we ship something like that, we usually have it under a feature flag and we like to measure it relates to our users. So basically, I just added a condition if, you know, the feature flag should be enabled and the user is running for so this new camera. And I was like, well, we will probably drop support for iOS 12 before it's like fully done anyway. So created this camera screen, like some nice animation and stuff like that. And we were obviously targeting like the very first version of SwiftUI. But it's worked quite well. Then for 2020, we dropped support for iOS 12 because we always keep like the latest two versions. Quite often, even more than that. Right now, I believe that we support like iOS 13.4 plus because of some insane combined crashes. So you have to bump it like all the way up to 13.4. And I mean, the experiment with the camera was quite a success. If I actually go back to it, the view that's rendering the video is obviously in UI kit. That like I don't know what it's called, an 80 something layer. Wrapped in a SwiftUI view and everything else is SwiftUI. And it worked quite well. So fall 2020 we started like heavily investing into SwiftUI. We decided that okay, since we're gonna start like moving to SwiftUI, we might actually introduce some sort of lifestyle guide. So we actually you know, every time we introduce a new element, especially in SwiftUI, we'll add it to our lifestyle guide. So everyone can see it. Okay, we already have this, you know, you don't need to create your own. We can also use some snapshot testing with that, maybe, you know, like stuff like that. As I showed before, we are basically running two different apps that are sharing the same code base. So, I guess you're aware that in SwiftUI, you can like, you have these slide previews. So we've added that you can actually render like what this looks like for Scruff and Jack'd for the side by side, which usually is like pretty much if you like run the same thing in like light mode and dark mode. But it's pretty cool that's actually we don't have any issues with developers wouldn't really be testing what it looks like. You know, we're running using Jack'd, so this has helped. And we started rewriting these quite simple screens that would seem to be relatively simple, like sign up screen, login screen, tutorial password screen. The only thing we've been avoiding is like list and grids of users because like don't be fast enough, stuff like that. Probably the biggest experiment was that we added this new account screen, like basically your profile screen, that we created to a new one and we wrote it in SwiftUI. I think I have some screenshots now, yeah. So on the left, I mean, basically everything except for that want to see more thing is in UI kit, but the want to see more banner is actually in SwiftUI and it's put on top of standard UI kit. The middle, the entire screen is in SwiftUI. And the middle one is also in SwiftUI. And it's worked quite well. I would say the most challenges we've had is because no one really knew how to like really use SwiftUI. So most mistakes that we made were actually like our fault, not some obscure bugs. And summer 2021, that's this summer. There's things such as if you want to use basically this SwiftUI version of collection view, that's iOS 14 plus. So basically, if we're like working on something new and it's going to be released behind it, we're gonna drop out soon, so you can use all the, basically the SwiftUI to the iOS 14 one. And at this point, every time you're like working on some new UI, you try to write in SwiftUI, only if we fail miserably, then we have to like it, but generally it's almost SwiftUI. And we're currently kind of in the process of researching, rewriting. If I actually go back and look at the last screen, the grid of users and stuff like that, we're looking into if we can actually rewrite and it's with UI, if it's going to be fast enough for the most part, and there's going to be some like insane glitches and stuff like that. The good parts and the bad parts. The good parts is definitely that developers are excited about writing UI again because, you know, I cannot imagine anyone who has like more than, I don't know, 2 years of existence has been excited about writing a, you know, table view or something like that. I keep reading like Twitter and places that at least the iOS 13 version of SwiftUI is extremely buggy. We have encountered some bugs or more like differences between iOS 13 and iOS 14 version of SwiftUI, but it has not been that much of a deal. Sometimes you need to tweak something. If you don't do anything crazy, which you probably are not going to do when you're starting with it, I would say the main difference is that on iOS 14, the elements like automatically avoid keyboard errors. SwiftUI previews are amazing if they work, which means a lot of things that I will get to. And you can mix UIKit and SwiftUI. Is it like flawless? No, far from that. But I believe that Apple has done as good a job as they can, considering how different those two worlds are. And, so. That's a spectrum place where I do a really good job. you have code coverage enabled for your target, as you should, SwiftUI previous just won't work because the way code coverage reporting works is that they like injecting some stuff into your code the same way ArcGIS, for instance, and it just doesn't work. So you need to either like have a separate target where it's disabled or just like disable it while you are working with SwiftUI previous and then obviously forget about it. We are in the process of splitting the code base into Swift packages, which would be a talk, you know, could easily be a talk on its own. I'm not really going to go there, but we're working on it, but there's still a lot of stuff like in the app bundle, and there's still some Objective-C mixed in, and it takes forever to try to compile that. And for some reason, like when you run it, it starts building like but I mean, eventually it will show something, but it takes like 5 minutes or something like that, which is cool. And SwiftUI actually is a totally different world, and it takes time to learn it. Like seriously, it's not like, you know, like it's like producing a little view collection view or something like that. This is like way different and more complicated, and you really need to start reasoning about things differently. I think the usual path is that you start working on something and it kind of works, and then you start digging into animations, and you, then you somehow, if you understand SwiftUI animations, then like you know, like understand SwiftUI, you need to rewrite what you wrote because it doesn't really animate. The issue with SwiftUI also is that a lot of things cannot be done. Such as if you take like the SwiftUI version of Scrolly, UI Scrolly, which is called just Scrolly, you cannot turn on paging, for instance. You cannot do stuff like the default, like the of UI get Scrolly is that it only scrolls, so like bounces if the content is bigger than the screen, whereas the SwiftUI version always scrolls, which is kind of annoying. It looks like it was a website or something like that. So what you can do, and actually, A lot of SwiftUI views are just Apple provided wrappers around UI controls. For instance, that already mentioned scroll view is actually a wrapper around UI scroll view. So you can either like ship your own version, or there is this third party dependency called SwiftUI Introspect. And what they do is they allow you to like pull the underlying UI scroll view, and you can modify whatever you want. That's kind of how they're achieving new standards with UI UIKit. It may eventually break, but you know, if it only breaks at a point where Apple, you know, has support for all this stuff that we need. I'm only like started looking into SwiftUI lists and grids. There's this thing called list, which is again a wrapper over UI table view, and that's fast. But there's these lazy H stacks and B stacks and grid stacks. And from what I've seen so far, that's extremely memory heavy and it's pretty slow. So we'll see if we can use it. I mean, it's like the point is that it's like loading, displaying, and hiding things that when they like appear on the screen and when they go off the screen, which is nice. But they stay in memory basically, like these cells are like not really buddies, they stay in memory. And it takes the difference between using the basically SwiftUI wrapper around table view and using those SwiftUI stacks. If you render like, I don't know, 1,000 elements, the memory footprint is like totally different. But you know, I mean, the question is it fast enough? And if it is, you can kind of assume that Apple's gonna improve it and fix it down the line. And so we will see. Another thing is SwiftUI, like navigation. I mean, if you're just like putting like UI views, that's fine. But if you try to somehow use the APIs that make it work with basically UI elements, such as you want to push something in an edition stack, you want to present something modally, you want an action sheet. It it's, I mean, SwiftUI is really great, but I believe it, there's something that Apple just needs to, like, where Apple needs to try again. It's navigation in SwiftUI. For instance, I believe that there's no way to, like, display two models over each other. I think I read somewhere that Apple has finally fixed it in iOS 14.5. I've tried it iOS 15 betas and it's delivered for me. So I've gotten some warning in console saying, yeah, you cannot really, you know, present models. So, I mean, I believe that if you want to try, I mean, if you have a standard app, you want to kind of, sometimes you want to programmatically navigate somewhere. You may receive a push notification, it's probably the most, and you press on it and you want to go and chat with the user or something like that. You may click on a deep link. Or, you know. I mean, from what I've seen, I think that this just simply cannot be done in SwiftUI right now. The APIs are just not there or they so buggy it doesn't work. Even with like the SwiftUI 3 or iOS 15. So basically, what we're doing is that we write a screen in SwiftUI. And then we wrap it in this thing called UI hosting controller, which is basically Apple's way to bridge SwiftUI back into UI. So we're writing our use in SwiftUI, but we're still using UI controllers for navigation and everything. And from what I've seen, we probably will for the foreseeable future. And one thing I feel is we actually have a lot of custom transitions in the app, so that the way they usually work is that you like take something from UI hierarchy and you kind of, you know, take the fragment and transition it into something. So I'm like, how are you gonna do that? You think that's with UI introspect or something like that. Now how do we architect our SwiftUI views? We've been using MADM for quite some time. And so we use view models. And my experience is that if you have a decently written view model, you can just take it from a view controller and show it into SwiftUI view, and it's pretty much gonna work. So the way we do it is that we have a view model, let's say on a screen that displays a grid of nearby users. So let's say you have a property that basically has an array of users you want to render in a collection view. We use combine that a published property, which basically allows you to reactive and subscribe to any property that you create, which is pretty cool. And the UIKit version would be that you have your own UI controller, you somehow inject the view model, just had a talk about ways to do it, and then you use that $users. That same, which basically means subscribe to changes, and every time that array changes, you know, the block gets triggered, then you can feed it to those different data sources, you know, collection view or whatever you want to do with that. The only difference in SwiftUI is that you make your view model confirm to a protocol called observable object, and as you can see, that observable object is not a part of SwiftUI, it's still a part of Combine, so you don't even need to think about SwiftUI. You don't want to. That's actually the only difference. And then you have a SwiftUI view. Again, you somehow inject the view model. And would it automate? And you use that property wrapper called state object. And basically, if you do this, what happens is that every time the user's array or whatever property you might just publish in your view model changes, go ahead, the cursor, yeah, this body thing called triggered again, and it automatically renders itself. So that's how it stays in sync, which is pretty cool. So to sum things up, should you start with SwiftUI? I would say yes, unless you're on some, like, you know, maybe if you work for an agency and you're on some crazy deadline and you need to deliver something in a month, you know, maybe starting from the SwiftUI is not the best thing, but if, I mean, it's, there's going to be a learning curve. You are going to learn it, you're going to get it wrong, you know, sometimes you don't really write stuff. But over and over it works, and I would say with like, iOS 14 and iOS 15, you kind of have pretty much everything you need. And if you don't have something, you can use that SwiftUI introspect to, you know, modify something on a collection view or stuff like that. So, I mean, our experience has been pretty much positive, and at this point I always almost feel like that if we like mess with UIKit or want to implement something new at UIKit, it almost feels like we're generating technical debt. So, because I guess like nobody doubts that basically Swift UI and the type of, you know, UI creation is the future, because it's being used vastly on the web from React and Vue.js. What I forgot to actually add is that Android has its own original SwiftUI called Jetpack Compose, I believe. And as I was looking at work, it's literally the same thing, but literally, it works exactly the same way. Just like there's some few differences because Compose is using Kotlin, but I mean, literally, it works the same way. So even if you like want to get start getting into SwiftUI, you can really get inspiration from even Compose, because Google generally tends to have like better tutorials than Apple. So look at React, even React Native, and get inspired by that. So that's it. Any questions?
Yeah. Could you show us an example of the SwiftUI prospect in your code? How to see this project?
Yes. So here is the list of things you can introspect. There's things you cannot introspect because it's not backed by UIKit, such as text, image, button. But yeah, this is it. So list in SwiftUI is backed by UITable. I'll make it larger. So you create a list and you do dev introspect. And this is actually the only way I know how you can, for instance, add footer refresh to SwiftUI. There is some refreshing in iOS 15. It only works with this list, which is UITableView, but you can have a scroll view. So if you want to do that, you need to use that introspect. So yeah, this is it all works.
I
think the state object is available.
No, I just checked it. It's like a visual SwiftUI control because it's not going to be
So I just messed it up. There's this other thing that we're using. So it's not state object, it's observable object maybe. So we have. I would say the benefit is that I've been lucky enough to work for a company that's doing good and wants to stay around for the next 10 years. And to kind of, you know.
So he's
saying
just
rewriting? Not necessarily rewriting, but when you work on something new, then it's good. It's with UI. Because, I mean, you cannot really rewrite an ad like in a year or something like that, unless you have an Uber or something, and how do the engineers set it so you need to kind of look to the future and look things gradually.
I don't understand that if you are going to use screens or something like this, but you are implementing low-quality screens. So
those screens were actually like super old, written in like some storyboards and Objective-C, and so we rewrite them anyway, and we could choose between like rewriting them in, you know, Swift and UI kit or something like that.
So basically, you're paying your
I mean, I'm trying to use it as little as I can or we. So, I mean, we were mostly using it only for a collection of use to add to refresh and stuff like that.
Because I'm great company. Because no one promised you that the list will always be backed by
a table. I'm kind of relying on the fact that, I mean, this will probably eventually break. That's why we're like trying to use it as little as we can, and we expect that when this breaks, Apple is gonna give us like SwiftUI native APIs to kind of do what we want. We're not doing anything crazy. We're like, you know, putting here just some separator style, which they finally added in iOS 15, I believe. So if you're interested, you can actually dump this line. So. I mean, option B is that you can, well, you can create these SwiftUI modifiers, so you basically don't have this code like 20 different times, but just one place, and you just add these modifiers, and you can just make the modifier do nothing or something like that. And if you're doing something really custom, you can always like create your own UI kit view and wrap it in SwiftUI. And that's yours, so that's not going to break.
Have you explored SwiftUI for other platforms than iOS, like Watch or iOS?
Not really, only like the Mac version out of curiosity. And I mean, if we like ship this app, like the Mac version of this app, it would probably be because we're a bunch of nerds, not because there would be some business like. But yeah, I've been playing with the Mac version because I can help it sort of.
Have you had any troubles when using communication patterns from UI?
Yeah, so what we basically do is that you have the SwiftUI view that's wrapping that UI hosting view controller. And as I said, we're using view models. So we usually inject the view model in the hosting view controller. So if you want to like somehow report back, you subscribe to that view model from that's what we're kind of doing so far.
Right,
maybe
so
we'll like get something. There is some like environmental object and stuff like that, which is basically dependency injection provided by Apple, but already using some object and stuff like that. So not using. Yeah, that's another thing. Apple has basically shipped a dependency injection framework or something like that. And if you look at Apple sample code, such as the Prud, I think basically create some model object or some store, and they like shall do the dependency injection thing, and then like move it, which is probably not going to scale. So they do that. Maybe, I mean, if you want to take a look at the reasonable SwiftUI app and how Apple does it, there's the Fruta app. It's like one of the sample codes from WWDC21, and I actually do that, and I was trying to do stuff like in SwiftUI, always present a model or whatever is on the screen. Let's say it's an app or something like that, and just keep shouting at me, oh, I can't really display models and all that, even if I was with me, so that's fine. It's like that. I mean, there's this website Hacking with Swift. Like every time I type something into Google, it actually shows even before the Apple's results as it should, because it's, you know, so much better than that. There's actually, I mean, people are really excited about SwiftUI. So even if you just, there's a bunch of videos on YouTube, for instance, about people like trying to do these fancy animations in SwiftUI and stuff like that. So I guess, like, for me, the moment of enlightenment. Oh, and there is a last WWDC, there is a session called SwiftUI under the hood or something like that. And they're finally explaining, like, basically, when you're like constructing these SwiftUI views, you're like creating this graph that Apple kind of takes and compares to the previous one, and like that animation based on that. And they finally explain, okay, how does SwiftUI kind of figure out whether two views are different or if it's still the same view and you're just changing background. So it should like animate it. It has these like implicit identifiers. So this is a very good talk. That was like my mode of enlightenment. Okay, now I actually know how to animate it since it's UI and I do a bunch of stuff.
I have actually had a recommendation for SwiftUI, which I found useful, and SwiftUI Lab.
Okay, I guess that's it. So that's it for our talks, and thank you. And I don't know when they're gonna make us out of here. There's much of food, actually. I might have some.
Thank you.